Hello everyone and welcome to We Meet at Digital Days. My name is Lisa Richter and I will moderate this presentation. We are very pleased that you took the time to participate in our virtual conference. The topic of this presentation is Unleashing GAN with High Performance Gauge Driving. Our speaker is Dr. Mike Wentz, CEO and co-founder from Mindset. He will hold the presentation and he will answer your questions. Before we start, I would like to point out one thing. You will be muted during the presentation. This means that you cannot ask questions via microphone during the presentation. Nevertheless, you have the opportunity to ask questions during the presentation at any time via the chat function. You will find the chat function in the control panel. This presentation will be about 30 minutes long. The chat questions will be answered in a Q&A session following the webinar. There are 5 to 10 minutes in addition scheduled for this. If we are unable to answer all of your questions within this time, we will answer them via email afterwards. If you still have any other questions left, just mail us at exhibition@we-online.com. We will try to answer all of your questions promptly. At the end of the webinar, you'll be asked to participate in a feedback survey. We would be pleased if you take the time to fill out a survey and help us to improve our event. You will receive the link to the presentation in the next few days, and the recording will be available at our website shortly. So now we'll hand over to our speaker, and I wish you an exciting presentation.
Thank you for the introduction. If all is well, you should be able to see my presentation. Good. So my name is Mike Wentz. I am the CEO and co-founder of Mindset, a company that does ASIC design or IC design for power electronics. And today I will be discussing or talking about unleashing GAN or how to drive gallium nitride transistors for power management applications with high performance. Here is the outline of my presentation. So first I will be discussing the advantages of using GAN, theoretically. Then I will talk about the challenges of using it, so in order to get those advantages. Furthermore, I will then continue to our answer to that, our high-speed GAN gate driver IC. I will have a few words on the MDC901 evaluation kit, talk about the applications of gallium nitride and our gate driver, thermal performance, and then finally, the conclusions. So, advantages of using GAN, I think, is today already quite known, but basically it comes down to that you are having an improved figure of merit, which means the RDS(ON) times your gate charge is lower compared to silicon MOSFETs. And also you will have a lower input, output, and reverse recovery, reverse capacitance, miller capacitance. Furthermore, there is no reverse recovery when you operate in the third quadrant or in reverse conduction. And finally, the temperature capability is higher compared to silicon MOSFETs. All this together makes that you are able to switch with a GAN transistor in a more efficient and fast way, allowing in the entire efficiencies for your applications or switch mode power supplies. Now, the question is, how can we actually enable that? It is important to realize that a GAN HEMT is no MOSFET. First, the gate voltage needs to be in a more tight way controlled because the threshold voltage is lower compared to a silicon MOSFET. Also, the breakdown region is lower compared to a silicon MOSFET. So you need a very well-defined gate turn on and turn off voltage. In addition, the rise and fast and fall times, so the turn on and turn off times of the transistors, are much faster than what you can achieve with silicon MOSFETs. So this will in the end lead to very fast transients, DVDT, that your gate driver needs to be able to cope with. In addition to that, the lower miller capacitance, or the ratio between the gate source and the drain gate capacitance, will be or make your transistor more prone to parasitic turn on and destruction. this destruction will be quite immediate if you get parasitic turn-on and you get a cross current in your device or a short current. Your setup will immediately look like the one in the right-left corner, which is some nice fireworks, but can be quite frustrating and also expensive, as it is time-consuming to build such a system. So to make a long story short, we need an optimized gate drive to avoid this kind of fireworks. So what do we need to look out for, or what is what are the pitfalls of driving GAN, or the challenges? First of all, there is the gate loop. So for some reason, I don't have a mouse pointer. I'll try to fix that. Yes, I think this will work better. So you have what we call the gate loop. Your gate is turned on, typically with a pull-up resistor, and turned off with another pull-down resistor through two separate paths. Now, your gate driver IC and your power device, your GAN HEMT, are physically two different devices, so there will be in between PCB tracks, and so then inevitably parasitic inductance. On your Kelvin source, you have a return path to your gate driver, which in addition will also have certain parasitic inductance. This is what we call the gate loop. You have this on your high side, but you also have this on your low side transistor or GAN. In addition, you have the supply inductance. So there will be decoupling, of course, of the supply with capacitors, but these capacitors will have a certain parasitic inductance in series with them, in addition to the PCB tracks connecting the half bridge to this decoupling capacitor. So the gate loop inductance, to start off with, causes a number of problems. First of all, it will create some ringing on your gate voltage. And this ringing will create overvoltage on the gate and create gate stress. In addition, it will limit your transient speed because it will slow down your gate switching. And last but not least, a bit hard to see maybe, but here you see that you can even get parasitic turn on because of the ringing. You might falsely turn on a transistor or the low side or high side that is supposed to be turned off. And if that happens while the other one is also turned on, you will immediately get a short cross current resulting in destruction of the half bridge. Supply inductance will have some other effects. It will mainly interact with the switching node, which is shown here in blue, and it will create overshoot and undershoot during the transients of your switching. That will limit your transient speed, so by increasing the gate resistors, you can slow down the switching and reduce this overshoot, but then you are, in the end, limiting your performance. So what do we need to watch out for? Well, first of all, these gate resistors, they are necessary to regulate the transient speed and also to keep the dissipation of your driver. In the end, your transistor's gate represents a capacitance that needs to be charged and discharged, and that goes hand in hand with some dissipation on your gate driver. Now, especially at high frequencies, these external resistors will make sure that the dissipation is located outside your gate driver IC and more in the resistors. Furthermore, the function of the gate resistors is to dampen the parasitic LC circuit. In the end, this gate is, as mentioned, can be represented as a capacitance. In combination with the parasitic inductance of your gate loop, this represents an LC tank. And this LC tank will ring unless you dampen it to a critical level. The resistors will help to dampen this gate tank. Of course, PCB layout needs to be done closely to minimize those inductances, but you can never fully avoid them. Furthermore, you have to take care that you prevent parasitic turn-on, especially the low side pull-down resistor should be chosen low enough such that when you, for instance, turn off the low side, that you keep this gate very strongly pulled down to the ground. When your high side turns off, that the Miller capacitance will not parasitically charge your gates of your low side too high, such that you would get parasitic turn-on. The drain source inductance is also there, so your in addition to the supply, you will also have inductance, parasitic inductance on your drain source, which will in addition contribute to ringing on your switching node. But it will also create negative spikes when you switch off your half bridge, or when you switch on the low side, you will get negative spikes on the source, which is connected to your gate driver in a Kelvin way. So this makes that your entire circuit is pulled negative on your gate driver side, and the gate driver needs to be able to cope with that. So if your gate driver is not equipped to cope with that, it might stop working, it might break down, or it might even propagate false pulses, which in the end also could destroy your system. And finally, these negative pulses also have another negative effect that is not unwanted, which is what we call overcharging of your bootstrap. So typically, at least the high side, but in a good circuit, also the low sides are bootstrapped to make them kind of floating and independent of this source ringing. But during the charging of your bootstrap, and when you get a negative spike, the bootstrap voltage will be added with this negative spike, and you get an overcharge. Now, this overcharge will propagate to your gate of your GAN hemd and can then create a reliability problem or even a breakdown of your GAN hemd. Other things to take care of when driving GAN is dead time control. So the gate signals shown here below should have a certain dead time in between. So you should turn off your high side before you turn on the low side transistors, and the other way around. If you make this dead time too large, you will have recirculation losses in the third quadrant operation of your GAN, which is of course to be avoided. In addition to, so you want to make this dead time as small as possible, but that requires a good matching between the high side and the low side circuitry to be able to do that. DVDT, so your switching nodes, and that's the advantage of GAN, can go up and down very fast. But your driver, at least your high side circuitry, will also see that. It will also fly up and down with this switching node. As there will be level shifters to switch the PWM to the high side, or to translate that to the high side voltage domain, you have to make sure that you do not get false gate commutation, which will in the end result in failure of your half bridge or even failure of the driver itself. So DVDT needs to be taken care of. And finally, this negative source voltage, that also is the reason for gate overcharging through bootstrap overcharging, is a mechanism that can create false gate commutation or driver failures even in your driver. So you need to be resilient to those negative spikes. So how do we solve that? Well, we have a very excellent solution to do that. And this solution is the gate driver that was developed at Mindset called the MDC901. In essence, it is a 200 volt capable high and low side gallium nitride gate driver with a 30 nanosecond propagation delay, which is quite fast for a good control loop stability. A 1 nanosecond delay matching to optimize your dead time as discussed. Very importantly, to get the maximum out of your switching speed, we are capable of reaching 100 volt per nanosecond and still work in a reliable way with this gate driver. So high speed switching is possible. Noted in blue here, because it's really a industry unique feature, is the driver strength of our gate driver. So we are able to source 10 amps and sink up to 17 amps of peak currents, which is also helping to enable high-speed switching. In addition, also in blue, because industry unique, is the fact that we can go up to -4 volts of source operation of the GAN without any negative effects, no false triggering or whatsoever. So this is also quite unique and important to work with GAN. Temperature capability, in the standard package, we can go from -40 to 125 ambient operation. However, the silicon inside is actually capable and also characterized to work from minus 55 to 175 degrees C. So we even have more, let's say, margin on that side. This is important. Why? Because your gate driver needs to be, for reasons explained, physically very close to your half bridge of your GaN. And as such, it will also heat up, because there on the half bridge of the GaN is the power losses are occurring there. Other features, again in blue, as a really unique feature in the industry, is the fact that we have onboard 5-volt logic regulators, but also floating supplies that are programmable. These floating supplies are really located on the driver of the high side and the low side, and they make sure that your gate really sees, the gate of the GaN really sees the voltage that the user intends it to see. This can be programmed between 4 and 6.5 volts to be able to be compatible with, let's say, all commercially available devices. So this will effectively avoid gate overcharging and increase reliability to a great extent. Another unique feature is our 100% duty cycle possibility of, or capability, I should say. And this is enabled by an on-chip charge pump. So in typical bootstrapped circuits, you need to keep switching to always continuously charge your high side circuitry. In this case, it's not needed. So you can actually keep on your high side transistor for 100% of the time. And then the charge pump will make sure that the high side is continuously powered. It's like this. So this both enables very low and very high duty cycles in addition to 100% duty cycle. Nevertheless, we have integrated bootstrap diodes to also accommodate higher switching frequencies. These will work together with the charge pump in a seamless way. Automatic dead time is also a unique feature in the industry, which basically senses the voltage on your high side, for instance, and when this voltage on the gate of the high side GaN is low enough and you are sure it is turned off, then only will you turn on the low side and the other way around. So this is really an interlocked, as we call it, dead time, that makes sure that you will always have a reliable operation with no cross conduction guaranteed. Moreover, this is a flexible dead time. So, or better even, it's adaptive. So if for whatever reason your GaN becomes slower because you're working at higher temperature, then this dead time mechanism will make sure that it follows the rhythm of the GaN. There's an internal temperature sensor for system monitoring, and there's, of course, under voltage lockouts to avoid insufficient gate overdrive. So this is how the block diagram looks of the driver, which I should say is a quite advanced driver. So it packs a lot of functionality. So here you have the actual output stages to drive the gate, with, of course, their related floating supplies, which is unique for the industry. And they are supplied by either the bootstraps, both the high and the low side are bootstrapped. And the high side can then, in addition, be powered by the onboard charge pump. There is logic and dead time generation to either accommodate this interlocked dead time or automatic dead time that senses the gate on your high side and then level shifts down the signal and allows your high and low side to be turned on when the high side is off and the other way around. We know that this way of working does not allow for the shortest dead time available. So for users that really want to push out the last percents of efficiency, it's also possible to have a feed forward dead time, which is digitally controlled with a few bits between 5 nanoseconds and 80 nanoseconds approximately. Now, this level of integration makes that the solution that we offer here is really compact. And looking from a system point of view, can make a high power density system possible. And this is demonstrated here. So our MDC901, which comes in a QFN 56 7x7mm package, if you pack all this or look at all this functionality and look at any commercial GaN gate driver, in addition to some passives and active discrete components to achieve all the functionality that we have, you will see that it is, as shown here, significantly larger and also needs significantly more components. So you can gain about 5 times PCB real estate by just using the MDC 901 compared to any existing solution. In addition to that, you will increase the reliability of your system because you don't have so many components on your PCB, which is also related to the reliability of your system. So in short, the MDCD 901 provides a decreased complexity on PCB level while allowing for high functionality and a highly robust gate drive with high performance of your GaN. We also feature an evaluation kit that is available from our website. The evaluation kit basically contains, of course, the gate drivers together with GaN systems, gallium nitride devices, and is configured as a half-bridge buck converter. As you can see, the solution is quite compact. As mentioned, all the required discrete components are, of course, the main filtering output and input capacitors and inductors, and then a few decoupling capacitors and gate resistors. So the solution is quite elegant and compact. So this is the complete view of our EVB, of our evaluation board and kit, where here in the middle you see the core of the board, which is the buck converter constructed around the GaN system devices, the MDC gate driver, and then the WIRT electronic output inductor. We have also nice WIRT electronic capacitors, connectors, and there is also a 12 volt switching mode supply to drive the fan, which is on the bottom side of the board and can be optionally attached. So everything in our kit is delivered to get the user up and running as soon as the box arrives, which is a nice plastic reusable box with everything inside, including all the cables, all the connectors, the active heatsink, a protective plexi cover, and let's say nuts and bolts to make the thing run as soon as you receive it. So standard, we are operating the operating limits are 20 amps, 50 volts. However, we are capable of going up to 100 volts with 40 amps, where, of course, the user needs to be careful with the limitations, which are mainly then thermally. Such a half bridge in gallium nitride can be used for a vast amount of applications, including battery-powered tools and portable tools that need high power. Also, server point of load converters and computers related DC-DC converters, audio class D amplifiers, high-end e-mobility and e-bikes, micro inverters for photovoltaic, and so on. So this is really a high performance solution that has many applications and much more even than these. I will go a bit more in detail of these applications and give you some examples. So for instance, on the EVB, we have the buck converter implementation, which is a half bridge with an output filter. And this shows, in fact, the switching node here, where the red curve is used when is obtained when we get the supplied 10 volt or 10 ohm gate resistors. Then you will see that you get fairly fast switching, the order of 5 nanoseconds or so, file rise and fall time. And it is very nicely rounded curve without any overshoots, very nicely damped. Of course, GaN can do even better than that. So if we lower the gate resistors to a lower value, we charge the gate faster and discharge it faster. And then you can really get to rise and fall times in the nanosecond range. Of course, inevitably, because there will be a certain amount of parasitic inductance on the board remaining, even though the layout has been done very meticulously, you will get some small amount of over and undershoot when you start switching really at the limits of what is possible. Nevertheless, this is still quite well under control and could be even damped a bit more if you use snubbers. Looking at the efficiency, this is an important topic I would like to go also a little bit deeper upon. So here you see the target or the example efficiencies of a buck converter with 48 volt in and 3.3 volt out and 12 volt out. The 12 volt out case is the solid curves here, which are a little bit higher. And here we can see that the efficiency reaches 96 point something percent at 500 kilohertz for quite large output currents. Here you can see that, in fact, if we increase the switching frequency from 300 kilohertz to 500 kilohertz, especially at lower loads, we gain in efficiency. And the reason is here, at lower loads, the inductor ripple current will create the biggest loss in the core of the inductor. And as we go up in frequency, the ripple current amplitude in the inductor will go down and associated. Maybe a bit counterintuitive, but even at higher frequency, as long as the ripple current through the inductor diminishes, then also the losses in the inductor will get lower. And so, especially at low loads, we benefit from a higher switching frequency when we switch with GaN. At higher loads, this inductor loss, at least the AC part of the inductor loss, starts to become negligible, and then you don't really see an effect anymore when you change the switching frequency so much. At 3.3 volt outs and the associated lower duty cycle of around 6 to 7%, there the trend is the other way around. So here we see that if we increase the switching frequency from 300 kilohertz over 400 to 500 kilohertz, the efficiency starts to drop. And the reason here is that the loss mechanism is completely different. Here, because of the associated lower duty cycle, the ripple through the inductor is much lower, such that, in fact, the losses are dominated by the switching flanks in your GaN half bridge. And because you are operating at such a low duty cycle, these flanks, or the energy in this flank, starts to become dominant. If you then increase the switching frequency, you will in fact see that it has a negative impact on your efficiency overall. And this is important because it breaks a bit the high frequency paradigm that is always referred to when people talk about GaN. They talk about higher frequency, higher efficiency, smaller form factor, higher power density. And this can be true, but not necessarily in a combined way. So you can get higher switching frequencies, you can get higher efficiencies, but not necessarily at the same time. This really depends on your application, and you really need to look closely to the application and to your specific use case. This is important to understand. Another application apart from a buck converter is, for instance, a LiDAR driver, where a LiDAR or a laser is driven with very short pulses at very high currents, can be a few tens of amps, and with pulse widths of 10 nanoseconds and even less. And this way you emit an optical pulse to an object which is reflected and sensed again. And what you do then is you do time of flight measurements, and in this way you can determine the distance to a certain object. This is being used more and more, from smartphones to future self-driving vehicles, and vehicles that can keep the distance to the next vehicle constant or adaptively regulate the speed. For all these applications and many more, LiDAR is used. So we have in fact already constructed a prototype with our gate driver for this exact purpose, and showing that, in fact, it works quite well, and it is also usable as a GaN driver for LiDAR applications. Another application is Class D audio, where you use the half bridge to do PWM modulation on audio frequencies, such that you get a very highly efficient audio amplifier that can have high power at the same time. Especially associated with our gate driver and the charge pump on board, you are able to modulate much deeper than with other solutions because of this charge pump availability. And yeah, compared to classical tube amplifiers, which are nice to look at, I would say a Class D audio amplifier is much more compact and can also be much more efficient. And at the same time, they do sound very good. Finally, I want to have a word on thermal performance. So here you see a side view of the evaluation board, where the optional heatsink that is supplied together with the evaluation kit is already mounted. So to give you the stack of the complete system, here on top, not visible, is actually the GaN power stage. Then you have the PCB in between. And between the PCB and the heatsink, there is a thermal interface material, which is isolating the heatsink electrically from the PCB. And then you have a pin grid array heatsink, which is spring loaded, mounted onto the PCB. On top of that, there is a fan, which can be chosen to be powered or not. If you do not power the fan, it is still highly recommended to use the heatsink, because it also acts like a heat spreader and helps to get the fairly concentrated heat out of your GaN half bridge away to the rest of the PCB and the rest of the system. So the total performance that we get with the fan on in this case is about 4K per watt from the GaN through the PCB towards the ambient, which is, I would say, quite performant. Looking at thermal images taken with this system, we have again two use cases. We have the use case with both 48 volt in, but on the left hand side you see 3.3 volt out, and on the right hand side you see 12 volt out. Output currents are in the same order of magnitude, 20 amps and 25 amps, and the same switching frequency of 300 kilohertz. Now, the immediate differences that you can see is at the low duty cycle case with 3.3 volt out, you see that the most heat is actually concentrated in the low side transistor, which is logical because at low duty cycles, this transistor will be on for 93% of the time, recirculating the 20 amps of current. So it will generate the most heat. Secondly, of course, the high side is the most heated, and then, or generating the most heat. And then thirdly, the inductor is generating also some heat, but not so much because the ripple is in fact quite low and you mainly get copper losses. It should also be noted that although your output current is in the same order of magnitude because of associated to the low output voltage, the output power is also much lower compared to the 12 volt out case. And so any power loss, even though lower than in the 12 volt case, will result in a bigger impact on the efficiency, which is a bit lower compared to the 12 volt out case. And also the temperature, the maximal temperature is lower. So if you look at the 12 volt out case, it's a different story. So the thermal image looks a bit different. Here, the duty cycle is around 25%. So already you see that the heat is much more distributed amongst the high side and the low side, while the low side is still dissipating the most heat because it's on 75% of the time. The high side is also taking quite some dissipation. And in addition, the inductor is also heating up quite well because of the fact that your duty cycle is around 25% and such. The ripple current through the inductor is higher, generating more core losses, more AC losses in the inductor. So although the power losses are higher compared to the 3.3 volt case, your efficiency is also higher related to the much higher output power. So all these things go hand in hand. So if you look at efficiency, you should always be careful and also always ask yourself, okay, at which output power is this referred to? And in the end, it's even better to get the absolute losses in watts, because this will really tell you what's going on in the system. Good, so then I reach to the conclusions of my presentation, starting with the fact that improper gate drive of gallium nitride creates a lot of problems, going from complete breakdown of your device to potentially, yeah, reliability issues or reduced performance, which all offsets the benefit of GaN. So you should avoid that. How can you avoid that? Well, of course, by doing very meticulous PCB design, keeping things short, avoiding any parasitic inductance as much as you can. But in addition to that, your gate drive is really the key to get transient speed, to get low losses, and to get a high power density. So all the benefits of GaN. I have presented to you the state-of-the-art solution as the MDC901 Gallium Nitride gate driver designed by Mindset, and also have shown you a range of applications that can be enhanced well by using GaN, such as DC-DC converters, LiDAR laser drivers, Class D audio, brushless DC motor drivers, and many, many things more are possible in a good way and in an improved way when using GaN. Well, finally, a remark is that GaN hems are today still not the most cheap components around. The cost is still higher compared to silicon MOSFETs. So if you choose GaN, there is a good reason why you've done that, and you want to get that performance. And make sure you get that performance and use the correct gate drive in order to make that happen. Get your gate driver right. So this is Mindset. We are located in Brussels, in Leuven, close to Brussels in Belgium. I would say if you have any questions, you can also or always email me after this presentation. And we'll be glad to assist you with any inquiries. I should also mention that Mindset is also a supplier or supplier of custom ASICs, so custom ICs. So if you have any other need apart from what I've shown here, please also feel free to contact us. We are highly experienced and highly capable of designing ICs, custom ICs for any power electronic application that you might have in mind. I thank you for your attention and I look forward to any questions that may come up now. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your interesting presentation. Like you already said, we will take a look now to the questions. One second. Okay, there are quite a lot of questions cost at a time. I think we can just use one now and the other ones will be answered via mail afterwards. So the first one, what is the maximum switching frequency of your gate driver and what is the main limitation here?
That's a good question. Well, the maximum switching frequency limitation is not really specified by the gate driver because it also is in relation to the GaN device itself. So in other words, how big is your GaN device that you want to drive? And the bigger they become, the slower you can inevitably switch them. But reasonably speaking, 10 megahertz is a number that is easily achievable with our driver. But again, related to the size of the GaN transistor that is used. And okay. I would say for maybe just to add, for many applications, this is not even needed. So you don't need to go to such high frequencies. The optimum for efficiency is much lower typically than these high frequencies.
Okay, great. So thank you very much. Now we've finished with this presentation. If there are any questions left, we will answer them via email afterwards. So thank you very much for your attention and I hope you enjoyed our presentation. The next presentation topic is high current, high voltage, PDUs and EMC filters for vehicles, and it starts at 5. See you there and enjoy our digital days. Goodbye.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.